The only people who don't want to disclose the truth are people with something to hide.
We got two. We got Sheriff Joe. Ladies and gentlemen, as Mike switches phones, please also say good morning. We had an opportunity to meet once, and he's been a guest from time to time with us. He's got a ton of guts. I like him a lot. Sheriff Joe Arpaio joins us, Maricopa County, Arizona. Sheriff, good morning to you, sir. Welcome to, back to the show.
Good morning.
And I think we now have Mike back. Mike, good morning again.
Good morning again.
Okay. All right, just if you would take off and identify when you speak, why did you set out to do the investigation in the first place, guys, if you would, and identify when you speak?
Well, this is Sheriff Joe Arpaio. You know, about 250 Tea Party from Arizona, actually from Phoenix, asked me to open an investigation, and since I'm the elected sheriff, I don't turn my constituents down, so I decided to look into this birth certificate and other so-called problems revolving around that birth certificate. In order to save taxpayers' money, I detailed the investigation to our cold case posse made up of former police officers and attorneys, and the commander of that posse decided to take this on, no cost, as I say, to the taxpayers. So Mike Zullo led the investigation. He still is, and he's doing a great job.
Mike, your credentials, please, before you begin.
And I'm a former police officer detective from New Jersey. I was a licensed investigator in the state of New Jersey. Moved out to Arizona in 93 and in 2005. I took the opportunity to join Sheriff Arpaio's posse in 2007. I was asked to be the commander of a newly formed cold case posse, which I still do presently, and about 12,000 volunteer hours I've given to the sheriff's office and the people of Maricopa County.
So what was the conclusion, and how did you arrive there?
What we did, sir, is... when I met with Sheriff Arpaio, neither of us had any real in-depth knowledge of this. We knew that this document was out there. We took the pathway of, we want to verify this. We want to validate this document, put this issue to bed. And that was the way we approached it. We had the computer file from April 27, 2011, and began to put this document through some tests. Initially, we were putting it through our own testing, and we were having difficulty having this document pass the testing that we were doing. At that point, we reached out to computer experts, forensic document examiners, and continued to put the document through even more testing. And ultimately, it failed every test that we put it through. We could not authenticate the document.
Examples of the kinds of tests?
We did a lot of tests with scanning, trying to get this document to scan and produce the nine links and nine layers that are found on the Obama document. Every time we did that, we would come up with computer-generated scans that would show 45 to 150, some as much as 200 links. We could not get it to link and layer in the same fashion, a random fashion that a computer program would do. There was obviously human logic involved. But the most compelling information we found was the fact that the date stamp and the register stamp certifying this document as authentic was actually imported into the document from an unknown source and placed on the document. In addition to that, they used to fill the background, because when you work on a document in a computer, it looks like it's on a white sheet of paper. It's got a white background. They manufactured the green safety paper appearance, filled in all those white spaces to give the document the look of an official document with a registration stamp and date stamp. However, you can lift the registration stamp and the date stamp cleanly off the document. You could put it anywhere you wanted to on the document. However, it would leave a white outline from where it was originally placed. That's how we knew the document was constructed.
Those are called, when this happened, we brought a lot of experts in, and it's called ghosts. And there's ghosts all over that paper.
Yes.
And it's amazing. And, of course, you know, I'm going to come back to Sheriff Joe if I could. That we have the video up of your press conference. You know, it was fascinating, and Joseph Farah wrote about it. Not one reporter ever asked either one of you guys, or anybody else for that matter, about analysis. All they did was question your motives and call you media hungry and the rest of that stuff. How do you react to that?
Well, I'm getting a little angry, quite frankly. Yeah. You know, I've been in the law enforcement 50 years, 30 with the U.S. Government Justice Department as a top federal law enforcement official. And now they come out with this. I knew it. Mm-hmm. The media doesn't want to touch this for some reason. They will not touch it. They call it a circus, which is an insult to dedicated people to work for circuses. But that's what they did. They do it locally. They never ask for the evidence, and that's sad in our country. If it was you or someone else who committed forgery, it'd be in the headlines, and they'll be. I would be the hero. But once you talk about the president, it seems like nobody can do that.
Let me come back to Mike Zullo, if I could. Mike, we have talked at great length about the president uses a Connecticut SSN. How did that happen?
We are not sure. The Social Security number is still under investigation by the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office. We have roadblocks, if you will, in investigating that. It has been what's called flagged. You can't run that Social Security number. You can't get any background information. So it's extremely difficult for us to make that determination. However, it's very difficult to also explain how I believe a 15, 16-year-old boy living in Hawaii ended up getting a Connecticut-issued Social Security number. Logically, it just doesn't make sense.
And I remember even when Bill O'Reilly said his father got it for him when he was at Yale. Well, I don't know how to break it or at Harvard, rather. I don't know how to break it to Bill O'Reilly, but that's not Connecticut.
Yeah. I know, and those are the issues that are out there. You know, there's a lot of disinformation out there surrounding this, but everything going back to Mr. Obama's history, I had a report to Sheriff Arpaio that I could not have him pass a background investigation to become an employee of Maricopa County.
Now, someone said he couldn't get past E-Verify.
He could not get past E-Verify at one time. That has since been blocked out as well. You cannot run him through E-Verify any longer.
What about his college transcripts and his admissions and actually Punahou School and the rest of that stuff? What do you do with that, Mike?
Well, those are the things that we're discussing with Sheriff Arpaio. Those discussions are ongoing. The sheriff is making determinations on how we're going to proceed. Those records are very difficult for us to get our hands on. A lot of those are sealed. But at some point in time, they are going to have to surface.
There's
a lot of unanswered questions, especially the Punahou High School, which I believe had a tuition back then of around $5,000 or $6,000 a year.
It was significant. Yeah, it was significant. I mean, Toot and Gramps didn't have that kind of dough.
No,
but
no, and obviously, what? Like you said, there is a link of royalty throughout his line.
What's also interesting, and tomorrow we have a friend who's now went back and revisited the president's when he traveled to Pakistan, under what passport did he use? And, of course, he's been caught lying about going back to Indonesia to see his mother, and then from there they went to Pakistan with two foreign-borns. But in the meantime, his mother wasn't there when that happened. So she was already back on, as they say, on the rock. She was back in Hawaii. So whose passport? What passport? They've covered all of that up as well. Who did he? What name did he travel under, and what kind of a passport, Michael, did he travel on?
If we could get that information, we could solve this whole thing.
Yeah.
We don't know. They will not release passport information on him. My understanding now is people are being told that his mother's passport information was conveniently destroyed in a fire.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
The list goes on and on. But Sheriff Arpaio had it right from the very beginning. Sheriff Arpaio said, we could end all of this if you show me the microfilm.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the man has got 51 years, as long as I've been alive, he's been a law enforcement officer. When he tells you there's smoke, you could take it to the bank, there's a forest fire. And he's right. There's something radically wrong.
There's something very wrong. No, I agree.
We've been sticking with the evidence, the facts. Now we have the other issue. I'll be pursuing the Selective Service card. That's very interesting. Came up with that. I don't think anybody came up with it.
Yeah, that's been looked at. I mean, I know you guys have really looked at it in depth, but that's bizarre as well. So, again, as others have said, poll after poll has indicated that a number of people, greater than 50%, have concern over the president's eligibility. And yet they have been able to dodge this. And, in fact, that Georgia case where they didn't even show up, they didn't even bother to appear. And I think as you're pretty pretty fair hand in law enforcement, or Michael, you as a detective, they didn't even appear, and then they simply got away with it.
I don't know how you can do that.
I don't either.
I just don't understand. I mean, it's being above the law.
Yeah.
And the major media, you know, mainstream media blackout is just mind-boggling the way they willfully ignored this press conference. If Sheriff Joe has an inmate slip in his jail, you know it from California to New Jersey.
Sure.
Something of this magnitude, nobody picked it up.
Yeah, and that's the part, again, as we'll wrap this, because I know you guys are having an incredible busy morning. Sheriff Joe Arpaio is with us, and Mike Zulu, who's lead investigator. And over the last on Friday, and you can see the whole press conference, it's up on our website, khow.com, and all the reporters did were just talk about Joe's and Joe and Mike's motivation, not one thing about the issue itself. By the way, both of you familiar with this Andrew Breitbart's video that's supposed to drop, and as you know, if you watch the internet, that can say anything, do anything, but about, you know, that how did Breitbart die? But he's about to, they apparently will drop this investigation into Obama at college. Have you guys been aware of any of this?
Well, this is the sheriff. I sent out my condolences to the family because he called me the night before the press conference. We had a conversation about certain issues, and then he died about 4 or 5 hours later. So that was sad.
This is Mike. I can tell you.
Did you hear that?
Yeah, I did, sir. I did hear that.
There is information that we have developed that the sheriff obviously is aware of that we believe is going to coincide with some of the information Mr. Breitbart was going to put out. So ours would have been independently verified. So we'll have to wait and see exactly what is released. But I understand it would be some devastating information.
Yeah, I mean, who did when he went to Occidental, who did he say he was?
Good as ours.
Yeah, and
we don't know.
And when they jump across to an Ivy League school like Columbia, after a second year with about average grades at Occidental, I've talked to people in Ivy League schools. I mean, Ivy League schools, that would have never happened in my lifetime to me. But to have, like, you know, be like a C student in an Occidental college, which is kind of like a, you know, a good time school, to end up at an Ivy League school for your junior year with, like, average grades, that was pretty, you know, depending on who you said you were again, correct? It's bizarre, you guys. It's I mean, for 3 years I've been reading this, and I don't know, man. I just wonder. But of course, as you guys know, only thing that happened to you guys is you guys were turned into bad guys.
Yeah, that's. I'm not gonna rush. You know, he's mentioned me quite often. I'm not going to condone what he said. That's a different issue. But let me put it this way. He just said a couple of things that made national, worldwide.
Oh my God! Yeah.
Here we have a press conference.
Sure.
We come up with evidence,
yeah.
And nobody wants to talk about it. You figure that out with the mainstream media.
But Sheriff, you know it. I know it. Mike now knows it. This is the hot potato. And how many times have you been called a racist since the press conference?
Well, I've been called that before. Yeah. I had the Department of Justice investigating me.
I know.
3 years for that. But no, you got to be careful. Maybe we tapped on something really big. You can't get any bigger than the White House.
I agree, you guys.
We're just doing our job. I mean, I wanted to clear him. I would have been proud to have cleared him. But then we come up with the evidence, and what do you do with it? I'm a law enforcement guy. Do I throw in a wastebasket? Then they'll think I'm covering up.
Well, again, that whole Georgia thing was so bizarre when the guy from the bench, and I forget the judge's name, Carter, I think was his name, but he said he didn't even show up. He said, I'm gonna file guilty because you didn't show. It's like, I've talked to attorneys. I sue Mike. Mike doesn't show up. The judge assumes I'm right. And, of course, then over a 72-hour period, and suddenly, nope, you're fine. You're clear.
Should have been an automatic default judgment.
Yeah. We'll get you guys both on again. I know your days are really, really busy. Sheriff, as always, and Mike, it's good to have you now as a friend, and we'll be speaking a lot in the next couple of months, I'm sure. Thanks, guys.
The only people who don't want to disclose the truth are people with something to hide.